You chose a good day to come because I know the Lord has brought you for a specific reason to hear the word of the Lord. Everybody say the word of the Lord. Now, that's the most powerful thing that you can hear. I mean, you can hear a whole lot of things, but to hear the word of the Lord is off the charts. And that's what we want to do. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the letter written to the church of Galatia, Galatians chapter 6. Actually written to the churches of Galatia, to the whole region. Galatians chapter 6. I'll be reading from the expanded Bible. It'd come up on the screen probably, but this I can pretty much quote without reading it. But you know, when you say you can do that, then you end up messing up. But I'm going to read it from the expanded Bible. Anyhow, Galatians chapter 6, verse 9. Paul said, we must not become tired or discouraged of doing good. We will receive our harvest of eternal life at the right time if we do not give up. Today I'm going to be talking on the subject, running on empty. Running on empty. Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we thank you for the privilege of being able to gather again today in this place with one another. For the body of Christ is a strength, Lord God. Sometimes there's friction, but Lord, more importantly, there's a strength that comes. Jesus, you said you would come and you would establish your church, and the gates of hell would not prevail against it. You didn't say anything about humans. You just said the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. But I pray that in the body of Christ there would be great harmony and unity. And that, Lord, as the body goes forward and does the work that the head has commanded, I pray that they'll do it, Lord, with finesse. That, Lord, they'll do it with ease. That they'll find themselves gathering at the cross and finding strength when they need it. I pray over every individual in this place, young and old, it doesn't matter how long they've been living for God, that they will be strengthened. That when they leave this place, those that are watching, Lord, they'll get something from this that will give them the encouragement and the power to go another mile and do what God has put in their heart to do. I pray over everyone, Lord God, in this place, and everyone that will listen, that their lives would be changed and enriched for the kingdom of God. For the gates of hell shall not prevail against you. And we take dominion over the flesh that we might do the work and the of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and of the kingdom of God in Jesus' name. Can you say in Jesus' name? Come on, one more time. Go ahead and put your hands together for the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise your name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Thank you for standing so long. Running on empty. People are in some respects much like cars. Everybody say a car. In other words, they have fuel gauges that tell them where their tank is, and they have fuel that's supposed to be in that tank. If you put the wrong type of fuel in there full of water, it's going to start acting up. Or if you don't feed it the right things or octane in that mixture, the fuel would not do what it's supposed to do. Both can tell when they are running on empty. They may have sluggish starts when you're trying to start it, and it will cause you to look at those fuel gauges and you're turning the engine over and over, and finally it catches because it takes time for that gas to get to where it needs to be to have that combustion that will cause that engine to start. And there's other times when you're driving and then it starts to hesitate, or you want to have some motion, or you want to have some pickup, or you want a burst of explosion, and you're trying to get somewhere and you just need that extra energy, and you step on the gas pedal, but yet it hesitates because it's not performing at the level that it needs to perform at, only because the gas tank or the level of fuel that you have in the gas tank is not where it needs to be, and it's supplying or it's starting the engine from what it needs to have that burst at the time. I'm talking to some people here this morning that are at a place that you're running on empty, and you're running close to the empty line, and God wants to fill up your tank today and put some gauges back where they need to be so you can do and go the distance like he wants you to go. Can somebody say he's talking to me? Yeah. Let me begin by stating anyone who has been in church for any length of time can testify to the fact that the Christian life can be compared to a long distance race, not just a 100-yard dash or a 12-round boxing match, not a mere 3-round Olympic contest, or even a full-scale war, not merely a territorial dispute. This is why Solomon said in Ecclesiastes chapter 9, again, the expanded Bible, the fastest runner does not always win the race. The strongest soldier does not always win the battle. The wisest does not always have food. The smartest does not always become wealthy. And the talented or intelligent one does not always receive the praise or favor. Therefore, it is imperative that we, that the faithful follower of Christ never allow his or her spiritual fuel tank to run dry. Today we will attempt to help someone who has been running on empty and hopefully give a clear direction on how to refuel or maintain a full spiritual tank, fuel tank. Somebody just needs to lift up their hands in this place. I'm feeling in this place, there needs some energy. You need to get some energy back in you. You need to start drinking. I mean, you've been out there and on the field too long. You've been working too long, or you've been doing stuff too long. You've been involved in things too long that you're being drained from your spiritual man, your spiritual woman, that spiritual being on the inside, and you're running on empty. In other words, how do you know that you're running on empty? When you get ready to do something for God, it's a chore. It's work to do it. You've got to motivate yourself just to get to church on time. There's something about you not being able to say, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of God. I'm talking about your spiritual fuel tank running on empty. You don't want to run out of gas, because when you run out of gas, it can damage the whole being. It can damage the whole vehicle. I remember when we first started our ministry, we took about 50 people down to San Diego, and I wanted them to be exposed to a ministry, a good friend of mine down in San Diego that I had friendship with for a long time. And he had a booming church and a very growing church and a thriving church and a powerful church, and I wanted to take folks down there. So we took about 50 of us down there and on a big bus, and then we had rented the bus from CLC at the time. They had this big tour bus at the time, and we rented the vehicle, and we went all the way down there, and we went all the way back. The problem was is that when we got to the gas station, the guy who was driving the bus is used to driving the bus. He knows how to drive the bus. He's a bus driver. You had to have someone who was talented and knew what to do if problems came about. So this is the guy that we hired to drive the bus. And he drove the bus all the way there. But we had to get fuel on the way to San Diego from Stockton. And on the way, we were there, and we stopped in the gas station. I had the money to give him. It cost us, I think it was $150 to fill the thing up. And I'm there, and I'm getting ready to pay for it. But I said, what kind of fuel does this bus use? I said, does it use diesel? He said, oh, no, we're unleaded. It's unleaded. Everything's unleaded now. Everything goes unleaded. And I said, but somehow back in my memory, I feel like that you have to put diesel fuel in these big buses. He said, oh, no, he just reached. I said, are you sure that you don't have to put diesel fuel? I'm standing by the pump, and I'm guarding the pump because I don't want him to touch the pump. He's getting ready to put unleaded in there. He said, no, we put unleaded. So finally, because of his expertise, he convinced me to go ahead and put unleaded. And we filled that thing up, and we filled it up coming back. And when we got back, and I was turning in the keys and signing the paperwork with the one who checks out the bus, and I said, he said, how did everything go good? I said, oh, we had a great time. He said, it's all filled up. I said, yeah, we put gas in and everything. It's all filled up. It's ready to go. It's ready to go on the next trip, wherever it needs to go. And I said to him, I just had a thought. I said, I thought we were supposed to put diesel fuel in here. The guy driving the bus told me that we had to put unleaded. And so we filled it up with unleaded. And he just looked at me while I was talking, and he smiled. He said, you're kidding, right? I said, no, kidding, I'm telling you. He said, Brother Delgado, you're kidding. You did not put unleaded fuel in that bus. I said, we filled that thing up twice and we put unleaded fuel. We put unleaded fuel in this bus. And he got on the phone right away. He called the mechanics. He said, start, pull that bus in the shop. Drop, put it up there. Drop those tanks off there. Let's take a look at some pistons and some other things, some injectors and things of that nature. And the Lord, by the grace of God, come on, by the grace of God, preserved that bus, and it didn't damage the whole engine, but they replaced some of the things that they need to replace so they wouldn't just go on into the rest of the engine. But God had his hand. I'm telling you, by putting the wrong fuel on there, you can destroy the whole man, the whole woman. You need to be fed the right stuff. You need to be in church. You need to hear the word of God. You need to be fed. You need to be strong. You need to have some fuel. Some of you are running on empty, and God is saying, let's put the right stuff. You are here and listening today because God is trying to fill your tank. Putting this passage into context, Paul is teaching on the law of sowing and reaping. Notice verse 8, I'm reading from the New Living Translation. Those who live only to satisfy their own sinful nature will harvest decay and death from that sinful nature. But those who live to please the Spirit, and the Spirit here talking about the Holy Spirit, will harvest everlasting life from the Holy Ghost or from the Spirit. This verse highlights that sowing to our flesh will leave us depleted and empty or decayed and eventually dead, while sowing to the Spirit will ultimately fill us up or give us everlasting life. Where do you want to get your fuel from what you do in the world or what you conjure in your mind? Or do you want to get your fuel from heaven? I have a fuel tank waiting on us right now that God is saying, I'm ready to pour in you. I know your nozzle is fit for me. I know it will fit in my tank. Lord, fill me up. Is there anybody in here that needs the refilling of the Holy Ghost? The old timer said, you need to pray through. Somebody needs to pray through today. Somebody needs to get refilled today. Somebody needs an initial baptism of the Holy Ghost today. When you drink of this water, you'll never thirst again. But keep this in mind. Never forget, whether we are sowing to the flesh or sowing to the Spirit, both have a draining effect to our spiritual fuel tank. Doesn't matter if you're spending it in the world or spending it in the church. All of it has a drain on us. This is why we can have good, well-meaning Christians running on empty, preaching in pulpits, serving in ministry, doing the work of God, and yet they're running on empty. The apostles Paul said in our scripture text, we must not become tired. Don't allow yourself to become tired or discouraged of doing good. You're doing good stuff, but don't let the good become bad or evil to you and turn on the inside. We receive our harvest of eternal life at the right time if we do not give up. There are things along the way that I'm going to share with you that will help you not to give up, but things that will help you. There's a whole lot of things that I will not mention for time will not allow me, but there's some things that we can do and some inferences that we can draw from the scripture that will help us not to grow weary and well doing, but in due season we're going to reap if we do not faint. We're going to make it past the finish line. That's what the Lord has for everyone here, that he wants you to cross the finish line. And there's things in our DNA, there's things in our being, there's things in our makeup that want to draw us back and that will deplete us. There are good things that you're going to do for God, and if you're not careful, you're just going to run on empty. You won't be able to burn rubber like you used to. You won't be able to pass the finish line like you wanted to. But the main thing is that you make it all the way. It's not to the swift, it's not to the mighty, but it's the one that endures to the very end. The same shall be saved. According to Dr. Herbert Freudenberger, a New York psychologist, when well-intentioned people try to reach unrealistic goals, typically they pour themselves into their work in a self-sacrificing way with very high expectations. After some time, they realize with disappointment that their efforts are falling short of their anticipated success. Rather than lowering their expectation to a more realistic level, they deny their failure and work even harder. Eventually, their energy reserves are depleted and they succumb to feelings of emotional and physical exhaustion. That may be you right now, and you've been wanting to lead a ministry, and you have been leading a ministry. You might be working in a ministry. You might be doing something very good for God, but you've been putting all your energy in there, and you've not been replenishing, and you've not taken time of rest, and you've not been putting the good stuff on the inside. You've let some things down and allowed the things of the world to take the things that are going to feed you right, and now you find yourself running on empty, and you're saying, God, I thought this is what you wanted me to do. God, I thought this is how you wanted me to live. Lord, I thought you wanted me to do this ministry, and the Lord is the one that put you in there, but you've got to realize that you and I are human beings, and human beings need certain things to go the distance. We don't serve anyone well, because if you're running on empty, you'll never be able to go the distance. Have you ever seen the new cars? They say distance till empty. In other words, your gauges tell you if you go further than this, you may run out. And pastor's saying right now, I'm your gauge. And if you go further than where you are right now and try and go the whole distance on what you have left in your reserves and in your fuel tank, you're not going to make it. That's why when it's time to come into the house of God, that's just, you know, you think coming, you've done God some service by showing up on Sunday or on Wednesday. Do you know that's bare minimum? That's not even a thought. I don't understand Christians don't come to church on Wednesday if you can. If your job prevents you, I understand that. But I mean, if just because you stay home, that does not compute right here. It doesn't. I was never like that, I guess, so I never know what that's like. And so I know that that's wrong. It's all 100% wrong. For you to choose to come on Sunday is wrong. If you can't, that's okay. See the difference? But choosing, I don't like her, I don't like him, I don't like that, I show up late, I want to hear that music. What's wrong with you? What is wrong with you? You're running on empty. Do you think I like all the songs? No. I actually said, I don't want to hear that one. But I... Why? Because it's not about me. It's not about here. It's not about now. It's all about him. And if I can encourage somebody by doing this to something that I don't necessarily care for, there may be somebody running on empty, and it will help them be re-energized and refueled. Let's take a look at three individuals in Scripture who ran on empty. I think it will help us. Number one is Moses, found himself running on empty. The great man, the greatest prophet or pastor that ever lived out of Scripture. In Exodus chapter 18, verse 13 through 14, and I'll also read verse 18 in the New Living Translation, we read, "The next day Moses took his seat to hear the people's disputes against each other. They waited before him from morning till evening." That's a long time. "When Moses' father-in-law saw all that Moses was doing for the people, he asked, 'What are you really accomplishing here? Why are you trying to do all this alone while everyone stands around you from morning till evening?' You're going, in verse 18, he says, you're going to wear yourself out, and the people too. This job is too heavy a burden for you to handle all by yourself. Jethro was telling him, you're going to start running on empty. If you keep doing this in the same way, you're going to find yourself depleted. You're going to find yourself wanting. You're going to find yourself wondering, why am I here? You're going to start saying things like Moses said, just go ahead and kill me. If you just take me out of here, the people are never going to listen, because he becomes depleted and empty. Notice that Moses was doing a very spiritual and necessary task, but always remember that spiritual and necessary can leave you running on empty if you don't use wisdom. Very spiritual, I'm talking to those that are in the trenches. Very spiritual things and necessary things are spiritual and they are necessary. But if you don't use wisdom, taking the knowledge and understanding and letting it cultivate and then begin to come out and be applied through wisdom, if you don't apply wisdom, what will happen is you will find yourself running on empty and wondering why I am in the position that I am in right now. Keep in mind that when we are running on empty, others will begin to notice. They'll look at your gauge. Like my wife does. Don't you think you need to get some gas? And I say, like a man, I'll be all right. I'll get gas when I feel like getting gas. We won't talk about how many times I've run out. I have not ran out a lot in the last 10 years. But in my life, I ran out of gas. I mean, I was a pro at getting out and the only one to push in my car. You know. Some of you are still doing that. You know, getting there, pushing enough, get in and steer by yourself. Yeah. But the others notice when you begin to run on empty, because they're in the car with you. It's your wife. It's your husband. It's your children. It's those closest to you that can see the gauges. And they say, don't you think we ought to go to church? You're kind of splatting. You're kind of jerking. And that little hesitation when you're trying to go up that hill tells you something. I know all the empty gas things. I know the distance, and when you run out, how far you can coast. And people see around you the gauges, and they say, you need a good praying through. You need something that's going to give you pep, that when you step on that gas pedal, you're ready to go. There's nothing holding you back. And others will begin to notice. The way Moses was able to replenish, look at that. The way Moses was able to replenish his spiritual fuel tank was to simply listen and to apply the advice of his elder. Moses was the great man of God. Moses brought 2.5 or so up to 5 million people out of Egypt. Moses was the man God spoke to on the burning bush and gave him the staff and said, I'm going to lead them out by your mouth and by your hand. I'm going to bring them out with the great move of God, and I'm going to use you. Moses was the one that everybody looked at when they wanted water, when they wanted food, when they wanted clothing, when they wanted a word for the Lord. They were all coming to Moses, and here comes one old man who wasn't even a believer yet. He was a priest of Midian. Not a godly one. And he said, son, what you're doing is not good. He said, son, if you keep doing it this way, you're going to wear out. You're going to burn out. You're going to start running on empty. I could see you're running on empty. He saw something in Moses as he sat there from morning till evening and how tired he would get. And when he saw what he was doing and what he was doing to himself and what he was doing to the people, you cannot serve your family. You cannot serve your church. You cannot serve God on a depleted, empty tank. You've got to be full of the Holy Ghost. And Moses Jesus was able to replenish because he listened and applied. It's one thing to listen, but it's another thing to apply. He not only heard what the old man was saying, but he applied what the old man was saying. Jesus is telling us we can't just be hearers of the word, but we have to be doers of the word. You can't just listen to Pastor online. You can't just listen to me sitting in this room and not do what I'm asking you to do, because it will not profit you. You can't just point out and me point out to you, this is where you're going to get full, and you don't come in and get full. You've got to say, this is the gas station. This is the gas tank. This is the nozzle. This is where you put it. Begin to fill it and fill it all the way up until you don't can't do anymore, and then come back again and again and again and again and again. He took the advice of his elder. Notice Jethro told Moses in Exodus chapter 18, verse 23 through 24, New Living Translation, if you follow this advice, here's what the old man said, if you follow this advice, and if God commands you to do so, then you will be able to endure the pressures. And all these people will go home in peace. And here's the beauty of it. Moses listened to his father-in-law's advice and followed his suggestions. Let it go down in your psyche. You know how to learn to listen. Stop doing your own thing. You got to learn to take the advice and the suggestions. I will always, my wife and I will always give you advice and suggestions. We will never tell you what to do. It's the way we lead. If you get ready to put away your wife, I'm going to tell you what to do. You do what you got to do. I'm going to tell you what the advice. I'm going to give you advice. I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. But you know what? Do what you got to do. Put away your husband. You want to go out and live in sin? Hey. I'm going to tell you the consequences. Pastor Tabby. I'm not talking to him, but I'm going to use him. You're like, oh, Pastor Tabby. No. I'm going to tell you the consequences of that lifestyle, but you know what? You got to pay. I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm going to tell you what the Bible says. But you got to learn to listen and take the suggestions and say, there's wisdom in that. And that's what Moses did. Saved his life. Saved him from going crazy and bald. Moses had an afro, I'm telling you. He didn't have this. The second person we want to look at is Samson. Samson found himself running on empty. Not only once, a few times, but he found himself running on empty. In Judges chapter 15, verse 14 and 15 and 18 through 19, expanded Bible, we read what happened when Samson was delivered bound to the Philistines by his own people. Something happened there. The Spirit of the Lord entered Samson. He said, we're not going for this. They're getting ready to afflict him. He said, the Spirit of the Lord entered Samson and gave him great power. The ropes on him weakened like burned strings, and his bonds fell off his hands. Samson found the jawbone of a donkey, not the bad word, but a donkey, a dead donkey, took it and killed 1,000 men with it. Samson, verse 18, Samson was very thirsty after this, and he cried out to the Lord, you gave me, your servant, this great victory. Do I have to die of thirst now? Do I have to be captured by the people who are not circumcised? Verse 19, then God opened up a hole in the ground and water came out. When Samson drank, his strength returned and he felt better, or he was revived. He was in the thick of the battle, and in the thick of the battle, can you imagine yourself killing 1,000 warriors with the jawbone of a donkey? No, it'd be hard to do it with the M16. It would be hard for you to do it at MP5. It would be hard for you to do it for any assault weapon, but he did it with one hand. Maybe he was ambidextrous and he switched hands. When he got tired over here, he started hitting with this and switching off. Whatever he did, 1,000 men And at the end of doing what he was supposed to do, he was running on empty. Never forget that anointing, the anointing of God, can cause us to run on empty. You think I'm anointed. There's a price to anointing. For preachers, they call it adrenal depression. A lot of preachers, and myself included, have found themselves after preaching what they felt was a height of whatever meaning they were in, way up here, feeling the exhilaration of the Holy Ghost. I mean, thoughts coming in your mind from wherever, God just anointing, and you feel the anointing, and the power of God is all over you. And after you come out of that, you're like a junkie. It goes through depression. They call it adrenal. Your adrenaline starts coming down. And the next day, it's just kind of a low. It's like you're crashing. In other words, you need another fix. But really what you need is like the prophet. You had Elisha and Elijah. And Elijah, when he came out of the great battle, he just needed a rest. He needed some food. And he needed a friend. You just need to come down to that and let everything slow down. And here we have Samson after this great battle, and he was anointed of God. But even anointing, and you need to know this, people, even anointing doesn't mean that you're a sinner. It doesn't mean that God's not with you. It doesn't mean that God has left you and the Spirit of the Lord is not upon you. No, it just means that you have expelled and you were used of God. And it's God takes you into heights and into levels that man was not intended necessarily to go. And he allows you to see a glimpse and feel a glimpse of what glory is all about. But mankind needs a veil, and that veil keeps us from fainting. That's why no man has seen God and live. We cannot gaze upon him because the power and the anointing of God is so strong that it would just dissolve us as human beings. But when you come into the presence of God and he allows you to have a glimpse of his glory and he begins to use you, don't get high-minded. If high-mindedness and arrogance is a result of your anointing, it wasn't anointing. There was a similitude of anointing, but there was a whole lot of flesh. That's why he said, not many mighty, not many noble, not many wise after the flesh are called. Why? That no flesh should glory in his presence. It's the anointing that would destroy the yoke and break the bands of wickedness. In verse 18, before that, always remember that running on empty can leave us totally vulnerable. Not only empty, but totally vulnerable to our enemies. You notice that Samson, in verse 18, asks the Lord, do I have to be captured by the people who are not circumcised? When he was in this depleted state and he was running on empty, he just didn't want the power to come back, but he wanted to have enough strength not to be taken by his enemies. And then we become, when we're running on empty and we're living from paycheck to paycheck in the spirit, what's happening is you are vulnerable to the enemies that are not against you, they're against God. But they take advantage of you, because taking advantage of you gets at God, because you are the apple of his eye. You are his offsprings. You are his daughters and sons. You are his ones, his called out ones that are out of darkness into the marvelous light. You're the ones that he died for and lives for even today. Because of you, he did all that he did. You were made in his likeness and in his image. And when Satan or one of his angels or fallen angels and devils begin to come after you, they're really coming after God. They're not hating you. They're hating God. But they know by getting to you, they're going to get to God. So when you're in a depleted state and you're running on empty, your enemies could come in like a flood. And you're just looking for a standard to be raised against it. I know this isn't the norm for most schools, but I'll just say it for the school I came out of, black belt. When I got my black belt, I came from a school that my instructor was a retired colonel who was a Superior Court judge who used to sentence people to his school. I used to laugh every time one of these convicts would come in to the school because they didn't know what they were coming. It was a reason why we only had 30 people in our school the whole time I've ever been there. The 30 people, and it was all like a revolving door. There was a few of us that became black belts that were really our black belts. You know, these days they give out a black belt. And when I went up for my black belt, we went through everything, all the kicks, all of this, all of that. My testing alone was 4 hours. Not 4 hours of kinda, you know, doing stuff, but 4 hours to the point that I was like this, dripping with sweat, coming down. This is the way we did it. This is just the way he did. But I'm just talking my experience. Dripping with sweat, and I was on the ground like this. And I was trying to keep my composure. And we were just getting started. This is like the 3.5 hour mark. He said, "Now we will begin to fight." I'm like, "Oh gosh, help me, Jesus." I didn't know Jesus then, but. And he said, "Stand up, Michael." I'm like, "I can't stand up. I can remember how I thought in my mind," and I'm like, "Oh, I can't stand straight." He said, "Stand up straight." And he called out, "Fong Lu Chong Ti Kwam Da Jing Da." Calling out these warriors who are all fresh. He started with white belts all the way to black belts. You will fight all of them. First, it was one at a time. By the time we got to black belt, I couldn't even dip, and he would destroy them if they didn't fight me like they were actually fighting. And we didn't have gloves, and we didn't have foot protection, we didn't have any of that. We had blood. And so by the time got to the black belts and did the black belt thing and got destroyed in that, he said, "Now we fight all together." I'm like, "Are you crazy? Use your senses." I'm like, "This doesn't make sense." All kinds of things were going through my brain. And it's just surrounded of men and women. You prepare to defend yourself. I'm prepared to die. But I got through it. Bloody, but got through it. And the point was that you've got to understand that God is putting something on the inside of you that you can make it to the finish line, and your enemies are going to come in and they're going to start swarming you when you're down. But God says that no weapon formed against you is going to be able to prosper. I don't care. You might be running on empty and you might be surrounded by all that, but you've got to have something on the inside that says, "I've got to get refueled. I've got to get re-up. I've got to have more on the inside of me." I know that it seems like when you're down, they just come on you like a rat pack. Doesn't you know, that's where these terms come. When it rains, it pours. Because it seems like when one thing happens, another thing happens. When this happens, another thing happens. When is it all going to end? I'm telling you when it's going to end. It's going to end when you get past the finish line. It's going to end when you come home. It's going to end when the Lord says it's over. And when it's done, he will say, "It is finished." I know those are one of the greatest words the Lord said on that cross. He said, "It is finished. You beat me, stabbed me, did all kinds of stuff to me. Slapped on me, spit on me, talked about my mama." Mary. And then he just hung his head and he said, "You know what? It is over." That's what Paul said. "It's over. I finished my course." Don't be weary in well-doing. Don't get worn out in doing what is right and doing good. For in due season, you're going to reap if you don't quit. There's everything's going to make, it doesn't matter if you're serving God or you're trying to serve God or you're not serving God at all. You're going to have to go through the gauntlet, and whatever you're going to do, you need to have someone with you that there's something at the end of this race. There's something at the end of this match. There's something at the end of this war. There's something at the end of this journey. It's not just going into the samsara. It's not just going into the abyss. It's not just going into the nothingness. It's not just going into all that is in nature. It's going to a holy God. Yeah. who's got crowns in his hands, who's got a scepter that's going to knight you. He's got things for you that you don't even know of. I'm here to encourage someone to get to the filling station, to get to the gas station, to get refilled, to get what you need and stop running on empty. Samson was able to replenish his spiritual fuel tank. And the way he did that was he called on the name of the Lord through prayer. The spiritual fuel tank is not only that we would come to God and we would say, Lord, fill me up. I'm running on empty and I'm taking advice of those that went before me. But you've got to come. It's good to listen to the elders and those that have put on you, put over you in the Lord. But you've got to have a prayer life that says, Lord, I know I need you right now. Somebody's running on empty like Samson right now. You got all these girlfriends out there and boyfriends out there. You've been doing this and been doing that. And God has anointed you anyway. Samson was visiting harlots, yet God was still visiting him. Don't let your anointing condone you for doing what you're doing. There will be a price to pay for that. You need to come to God and say, Lord, help me to develop my prayer life. When he really needed to be refilled, he didn't look to man, he looked to God. And he said, God, don't let me die like this. Lord, don't let my enemies have triumph over me. Don't let my enemies send captors who are uncircumcised take me out. Lord, fill me again. And some of you may be in that place right now that your prayer life is not where it needs to be, but God says, let's get it together. Listen to the elder here today, but also listen to God. And do what he tells you to do. And the final person as I close is Naomi. Some of you know her. She found herself running on empty. She had a husband and a couple of boys when she moved to Moab. And she moved there because of a famine and she was trying to make a better life for herself and they did well in Moab. Her two sons married two women, Ruth and Orpha. I said last time, Oprah. My wife said, you said Oprah. Hey, I'm so 21st century. Orpha. And they married these two girls, and in the process of time, her husband died, and her two boys died, and she had to go home, back to Bethlehem in Judah. And here she is after coming home. In Ruth chapter 1, verse 19 through 21, notice, and it came to pass when Ruth and Naomi, because Orpha went back and Ruth went with her, Ruth and Naomi were come to Bethlehem, that all the city was moved about them. They were excited. And they said, is this Naomi? She's been gone for 10 years now. And she said unto them, call me not Naomi, or my pleasant, or my delight. Call me Mara, which means bitterness. For the Almighty hath dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full tank of gas. And the Lord hath brought me back home again empty. I'm running on empty. Keep in mind that there may be times we may feel as though God has been siphoning your spiritual fuel tank, causing you and I to run on empty. There may be times you think God has this hose on your spiritual life. He's causing you to do all this, calling you to great things, and the whole time he's siphoning. You blow first, and then you stop. How do I know that? How do I know these things? I don't know. It tastes nasty. Thank you for the blood, Lord. And you feel like God has that hose down your tank and he's draining you. You thought you had more fuel in the tank You thought more of yourself. You had this altruism. You thought you were going to save the world. You thought that, man, I'm the man, I'm the woman, I feel the Holy Ghost, and now you've been doing what you're doing for a while, and it seems like God put you in this thing, and he did, but it seems like he's been siphoning and causing you to run on empty. Notice what Naomi said in verse 20 and 21, the Almighty, you, the Almighty had dealt very bitterly with me. I went out full, and the Lord had brought me home empty. In Ruth chapter 1, verse 16 through 17, New Living Translation, notice Naomi's glimmer of hope. Out of all that she felt, the glimmer of hope, Ruth replied, don't ask me to leave you and turn back. I know Orpha's gone back, but don't ask me to leave you and turn back. Where you go, I will go. Wherever you live, I will live. Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Wherever you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me severely if I allow anything but death to separate us. This was her glimmer of hope. I have someone, and God's going to put maybe someone in your life that's not going to give up on you when you're at your lowest point, and you may be on empty right now, but somebody called you, somebody prayed for you, somebody believed in you. It's a glimmer. It's a ray. It's the cloud the size of a man's hand. Now, because Naomi chose to bring Ruth back to Judah with her, and Ruth's willingness to remain with Naomi, Ruth ended up, notice, I'm not talking about Ruth today, but Ruth ended up marrying the man of her dreams, Boaz. She married the man of her dreams, Mike-as. Hallelujah. Ruth also became aligned in the lineage of Jesus Christ because of the decision and having to go back with her mother-in-law. But notice what Boaz did for Naomi. Notice in Ruth chapter 3, verse 16 through 17, New Living Translation, when Ruth went back after being with Boaz all night, it went back to her mother-in-law. Naomi asked, what happened, my daughter? Ruth told Naomi everything Boaz had done for her, and she added, and he gave me 6 scoops of barley and said, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed. I know she's running on empty, and I want you to bring this back to your mother-in-law and give it to her and say, the full days are coming back. The good days are coming back. You're going to prosper again, and I'm here to tell someone right now, you may be running on empty, but God says today, I'm giving you more than when you went out with. I'm going to bless you and those around you, because you're not going to remain on empty all your life. Naomi, as I end here, was able to replenish her spiritual fuel tank by faith, the faithfulness and the loyalty of another woman. She was able to be replenished. Yes, Boaz gave to her, but she was able to be replenished not just because of Boaz, but because she had a companion. She had a friend that was sticking closer to her than a brother. There are brothers in this place that need to link up with other brothers and sisters in this place that need to link up with other sisters. And you need to get together and say, I can tell you're running on empty, but I'm staying with you. Where you go, I'll go, as long as it's in the church. Where you die, I'll die, as long as it's in the church. Your God shall be my God, as long as he's Jesus Christ and through him that you're serving, I am with you. She was replenished, as we all stand, because of another woman. Many of you will be replenished because of another person in your life. The 3 things that I summarize with that are necessary to keep from running on empty is, number 1, you need headship. Like Samson, you need a prayer life. You need to have thoughts from above. You need leadership. Like Moses, listening to those that are over you in the Lord. Listening and taking their advice. And you need friendship or companionship. Like Naomi had, that helped her to glean and to be refilled. The Lord is speaking to somebody. To a whole lot of somebody. It may be that you're running on empty because you've been running from God. It may be that you're running on empty because you've been doing so much for God. Since your fuel tank is leaking, time to come to the repair shop. Your fuel gauge is broken. That's kind of like bad. So you're always running, trying to get gas, and then if you try and go a little bit longer, you run out. You're just low. No condemnation there. But God is saying, come on, all you that are laboring and are heavy laden, come into me and drink. So if you're here today, and maybe you're just starting on this journey, you're just trying to get into the filling station, you're just trying to get God, this is the best time. But don't let this be the last time that you come to this altar, that you come to the Lord, that you listen to the advice of this elder and other elders here. Don't let it be the last time that you listen to the advice from your friends and look for friends and companions that will help you stay full. You may be that person that's just coming, or maybe you're in that spot where you're just saying, I need a good praying through. I need a good friend. I need to start listening to the pastor. I need to start listening to the teaching that comes here in different classes, my marriage, in my single life, in my youth life, in my hyphen life, in my elder years, in my leadership style, in everything. I invite you to the altar right now.